the mystery of being born again in relationship to being a disciple of Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Who is a true disciple? Revelation chapter 2, verse 2. I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which they say they are apostles and are not, and have found them liars. So we are getting there. But let me just make this for the form of introduction. You see, there are people that say that they are born again, and the truth is that when we go to scriptures and dissect scriptures with truth and in spirit and in sincerity, telling you the truth and not even the truth, for Jesus is the truth teller. And after we dissect scriptures, there are a lot of people that you find out that they are not really born again. And they themselves can look at themselves and say, indeed, we have heard testimony. We have heard testimony. I can tell you that I am also testified. Now, when I thought I was born again, I was not. And so it's not about you, it's about us, it's about you and me. We need to be sincere to ourselves by looking at scripture. Forget about that I'm going to church. I've been in church 25 years. I am a pastor, I am a deacon, I am an elder. Forget about all those titles. There are people hiding under those titles and they are not born again. And they don't even understand what it means to be born again. Born again is a mystery to be understood by men. If you want to know more, I'm not going to deliberate more on it, because this is just part of what we have been discussing for the past 1 month now, or 3 weeks or so, about the mystery of born again revealed. Check the messages, check all the different messages, so that by the time you get to this stage, you now know where we are coming from and what this mystery is all about. Because if you don't understand the mystery of born again, I am telling you, many will be shocked on the last day that their name is not even written in the book of life. And it was never ever written in the book of life. Not to talk of the one that it was written and it was removed. No. The fact that it was even never ever written. And then three they said they are born again. Why? Because the Bible is written to them. Just as there are men who say they are apostles and they are not, and we found them liars. So there are people in churches who say they are born again and they are not, and they are lying to themselves. And some of them are pretending, they will pretend and they lie to themselves. So let's just look. Let us look at this aspect of somebody say, I'm a disciple of Christ, being a disciple. And how does it relate to you being born again? Amen.
Amen.
Now, let's go to the scripture in the book of Matthew, chapter 11, the verse. We're going to start with Matthew, chapter 11 today. Somebody say, Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord. You know, let's check this out. Who is a disciple? A disciple is somebody that is learning. A disciple is, in primary school, you say it's a people. You know, somebody that is learning. In Africa, you can say a landboy. Somebody that is doing what? Learning. You are learning from somebody. In our own higher institutions, we use the word a mentor and a mentee, or a protege, and you use all those words, a protege and all that, Amen.
Amen.
So in this case now, Jesus is the mentor. Amen.
Amen.
And we are supposed to be his disciples, people that they are learning from him, people that he's trained, people he's teaching. So let's look at Matthew 11:28. And 29. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. See here, we are learning something. Jesus is telling the people that learn of me. Exactly, somebody. In this context, a disciple of Christ, somebody that considers themselves a disciple of Christ, is somebody that is willing and ready to humble themselves and learn of Jesus. and learn of the master, learn of to learn of him. If you spend all your years in church, the question is, who are you learning from? Or not only that, who are you learning of? Or another question I'll ask you, why are you in that place? What is your purpose of being there, a member of that church, or going to church? Going to church, what is your purpose? To go and learn of my master. To go and learn of him. To go and learn what? To go and learn of his attributes. Why? Because the Bible makes me to understand that it is possible to be like him. For the Bible says, as he is, so are we in this world. Or in another way, you can say, paraphrase, for as he is, so are we supposed to be in this world. No other difference. Let us go to Matthew chapter 10. Matthew chapter 10. Matthew chapter 10, verse 24. Matthew chapter 10, verse 24, from verse 24. The disciple is not above his master, nor the servant above his Lord. It is enough for the disciple that he be and his master, and the servant as his Lord, if they have called the master of the house visible, how much more shall they call them of his household? What I want us to see here is that a disciple can be like a master. That means it is possible for you to be like Jesus. After you learn of him, it is possible to be like him. Amen.
Amen.
Now, when we say to be like him, we'll find out what does that really mean in scriptural context. Because it is very important for the church to understand, according to the Great Commission that was given to every child of God, and especially those who have been called to the fivefold ministry and to other subsidiary ministries in relationship to the kingdom business. Matthew chapter 28, let's check it out. Let's go to Matthew chapter 28. In a familiar scripture, I want to say something there about this issue of discipleship, of being a disciple. In Matthew 28, verse 19 says, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And 20 says, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Now, if you look at that context right there, when he said teaching them to observe, when he said teaching them to observe all things, he said, when he said teaching them to observe all things, you are actually making disciples. Because he said, go ye and make disciples. In another translation, this is the version now, in the Living Bible, in the other translation, you see, you know that the Bible now makes you understand. Go ye and do what? Make what? Make disciples, right? Mm-hmm. How do you make disciples? By teaching them to observe all truths. By teaching the people to observe all doctrines. By teaching people to observe all doctrines, all truth that the Bible has commanded people to know, by teaching them everything, line by line, precept by precept. Because if you don't do that, you cannot make them disciples. They cannot become disciples. And that is why we have a lot of people in churches that they are just there, sitting on benches, warming the benches. Not really disciples. It's very serious. Now, listen to something that the Lord said here in, let's see John chapter 15, verse 1 and 2. Verse 1 and 2. We are dealing with this aspect of who is a disciple, who is a true disciple, and the fact that we have to go out and make them disciples. In John chapter 1,
John chapter 15, sorry, 15, 1.
I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that he may bring forth more fruit. Go to Matthew 12, verse 30. Go back to Matthew 12, verse 30. Matthew 12, 30 says, he that is not with me is against me, and he that scattereth not with me scattereth abroad. See, a disciple is supposed to be like Christ. A disciple is supposed to be like Jesus Christ. If you say you are a disciple and you are not like Jesus Christ, you are not living a life like Jesus Christ, you are not operating like Jesus Christ, then you are whatsoever you say you are born again, have a big question mark. I will show you now what we just read in John chapter 15. It says, he that is within that me, with me, if you do not bear what fruit, that fruit is in two level. Two level. First level, he's talking about the attributes of God. He's talking about the characteristics of Jesus Christ. What is that? In relationship to lifestyle, fruits of the Spirit now. That is relationship to lifestyle. Bear fruits of holiness because God is holy. Bear fruits of love because God is love. Bear fruit of compassion because God is compassionate. Bear fruit of goodness, mercy, loving kindness, because those are all the kind of attributes of him. We just learned in Matthew 11, for he is meek and lowly. He's a meek and lowly person. Bear fruit of humility, lowliness, meekness. That's why I said, learn of me. Learn of me. You can be like me. You can live like me. You can act like me. Is it possible? Yes, it is possible. Because a disciple can be like the master. Is it possible? Yes, it is possible. Because the Bible says, as he is, so are we in this world. So means that, so are we supposed to live like him in this world. For any man that hath this hope of heaven, the Bible says, cleanse themselves, purge themselves, cleanse themselves, keep themselves pure, because they have a hope. So, the second level is that he that is a true disciple who has not become like the master will do what the master does. The master is a soul winner. The master was a soul winner. He was a fisher of men. He called them out and said, now I'm going to make you fishers of men. Because I came here on earth to be a fisher of men. And I want you to be like me. I want you to have the same mission like me. Have the same vision like me. Have the same motives like me. Have the same focus like me. You don't have to be here on earth, and you cannot focus to win souls. You cannot focus to bring men to Christ. You cannot focus to be a fisher of men. Then you are not gathering with Christ. You are scattering with Christ. And if you are scattering with Christ, you don't belong to him. Only those who are gathering with him belongs with him and for him. And I'm talking to somebody who has been in church all these years, and in your life, none of these things are happening. If it comes to character-wise, if it comes to lifestyle-wise, when they look at you outwardly, they look at you inwardly, you are nowhere to be found. But you have been in church for 20-something years, and the people who are in church, who say they are pastors, most of them are not pastors. Those people you call them bishops, most of them are not bishops. Those people you run after the prophet, most of them are not prophets. Because there are many of them that call them teachers, prophets, apostles, whatever type they carry, and they are not, they are liars. God does not even know them. They are not even born again. And that's why, instead of those people to make you a disciple, to make the disciple to become like Jesus Christ, both in lifestyle and in the Great Commission, They have not made you to become anything. And you sat, you have been sitting down in that church for years upon years upon years, because all they are interested about their life is to collect tithe and offering from you. All they are interested about their life is that you should become a number in their church. Increase the people sitting in that church. That's where their focus is. But they have left the Great Commission. The reason why they have left the Great Commission is because they are not part of Jesus Christ. Because if you are like Jesus Christ, you will focus on what Jesus is focusing in. How do you know a false prophet? How do you know a false apostle? How do you know a false teacher? These are some of the things you can notice about them. It's not all of the things, but this is one of the aspects you can even think of. Because there are even some people who can pretend that they are going to win souls, but guess what? They are not different from the Pharisees and the Sadducees. The Pharisees that Jesus spoke about, these guys, that you go miles upon miles to go and make one convert and bring and make the worse than you. How many of them are going to the street to look for people to come and join their church? And when they broken, the people have come to the church, they are worse, they make them worse than even before they were. Prostitute become prostitute twice, prostitute. Corrupt and become more, because they will come to church and see more corruption. They will come and see more greediness in the church. They will come and see backbiting. They'll come, oh Jesus. Is that a church? Listen, is that the kind of church you think Jesus is coming to rapture? Those are the kind of people Jesus is coming to rapture. Jesus is coming to rapture people who are portraying, who carry his kind of attributes, his kind of lifestyle, who are bearing fruits of righteousness, who are bearing fruits of a holy living. And any man or woman that is not bearing those kind of fruits, you are not living, you are not having those lifestyle of holiness and righteousness, just know that he will cast you out. He has already cast you out. He has cut you off long time. You are not out there focusing on soul winning. You are gone long time because you are scattered. That's why in Revelation, he says what? He says, I will vomit you out if you are neither hot nor cold. You cannot serve God and serve mammon. You cannot serve light and darkness. Light and darkness cannot go together. When you find yourself struggling to serve light and darkness, to serve God and mammon, you've got a question mark on your so-called that you are born again. You are not actually born again. You've got an issue. And you need to sit down and find a word-based church or a word-based pastor or leader to teach you how to live like Jesus. To show you what Jesus expects of you, both inside and outside, what he expects of your life. Because if not, you become those people that the Bible says, men of almost miserable. Men of almost miserable. Who think that salvation and coming to Christ is all about the blinks of this world. Who is a true disciple? Let's continue. Who is a true disciple? To prove that this person, you can say, this one is born again. Let us go and look at it more. In the book of Luke chapter 14. Luke chapter 14. In the book of Luke chapter 14. Let's see another style, lifestyle. Luke chapter 14 from the verse 20, the verse 26. The Bible says, if any man come to me and hate not his father and mother and wife and children and brethren and sisters, yea, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. And whosoever doeth not bear his cross and come under me cannot be my disciple. 33. So likewise, whosoever he be of you that forsaketh not all that he hath, he cannot be my disciple. You see, and that is why we said before in the previous messages, that is why God said, my son, my daughter, give me your heart. Give me your heart. Because if you don't give, if you and me don't give our heart to Christ, and it does not have access to it, to dissect it and bring out those wickedness and bitterness, there is no way you and me can fulfill the scripture. Because it is when somebody gives their heart to him, then now when he finishes that heart, then now you can look at this world and say, indeed, with all boldness, I am in this world and not of this world. That is when you can look at this world and say, with all your passing pleasure, oh, Mr. World, I am not part of you. Oh, Mr. Flesh, in me, you must die. It is at that second, look at your father, look at your mother, and your brothers and sisters who don't like the way you are, who don't like the way you are living your life right now. Because to them, you don't do what they do anymore. You don't dress like them no more. You don't talk like them no more. You don't go to the kind of parties that always go with you. Your life is different. Now you are a man or woman that is consecrated to Christ in prayer, in fasting, in studying the word, in striving for heaven. And the wonder, because you have given your heart to Christ, and Christ took the heart and he has worked on it, and now you have come out on the other side as gold. Then now, you are now ready to carry your cross, because Jesus is saying, if a man says he wants to follow me, and you have not reached the point in your life that because of me, Christ Jesus, you can look at money and run away. You can look at that job that is telling you to go get $80,000 job, $100,000 job. Yeah, man, it's good, it's a bit nice looking, juicy. But the cost of getting that job is you have to compromise, you have to lie. You have to do all kind of evil, all kind of compromisation, and then you finally got a job and you say you are in church, you are born again. You are not. You are not. He that is born of God do not commit sin. You are not born again. You are not. Do you see that? Because you are not ready to forsake money, forsake jobs, forsake whosoever. Bring some relationship must come down. There are relationships that are toxic relationships. How are they toxic? Because their goal is not to help you to make heaven. They are toxic because they are, you see, birds of the same feather flock together. You cannot tell me that that is your friend. And when I look at your friend, you look like a prostitute. And all these years, you are not talking to that friend. To even advise the person. If you are at least you've been trying, then guess what you do? Your friendship will be different. There are dimensions of friendship. There are some friendships that are deep and that are shallow. We understand. Because it depends on the second criteria. If the Lord has not worked in your heart, and if you and me, if you have not given your heart to Christ completely for him to do it, to work it out, to dissect it, you cannot be his disciple. Because example is that one that, see, don't mind all these things that people are coming to churches today, they hear true gospel, they argue, they fight each other, they run away, go to place to place. Let me tell you something. All that manifestation is a sign that you are not ready for change. You are not even born again. It's a sign to say that even Jesus himself has not gotten hold of your heart. Because a man that he gets hold of your heart, they become humble. They become submissive to the word of God. They fear the word of God. They humble themselves down to the word of God and receive the word of God as pure milk. That is not having no corruptibility. Are we ready? Are you ready to forsake your husband persecution? He doesn't want you to live holy. Name them: job, education, vision, career, your musical skills or your ministerial skills and talents and aspirations. Are they all boxed inside of holiness and righteousness? Is that a goal? Or do you have other ulterior motives for people to know you, to have more names, to build a church, to become this? All those things, is that your motive? Is that what you're looking at? Then you are men of all most miserable. What is Jesus saying here? He said, if any man cannot carry that cross, the life of the cross is the pathway to victory. The life of the cross is a life of persecution, trials, suffering. It's a life of you gotta go all the way with Christ. For he suffered as an example for us, that those who want to follow him, scripture makes us understand, will also go through those kind of suffering. For if they call a man of God, Jesus Christ, Son of God, Beelzebub, they will also call you all kinds of names. In quote unquote, if actually you are living right. Because if in quote unquote they are calling you names and it's true, because there are people together that call themselves pastors and they are dupers, and people call them that you are a duper, and it's true they are dupers. But there are some cases that they can call you a name that it is not true. And why? Because they are persecuting you because of your righteousness. They are persecuting you because of the truth you carry. They are persecuting you because of the holy life you are portraying and giving out. those persecutions are going to be there. So if you look at it, if you check yourself and search around yourself and look around yourself, check, you judge your own self and say, no, what you're saying is wrong. You move on. You pray with your God and come, keep worshiping because it's a distraction from the devil. I'm talking to those people now who are having this kind of experiences. Some people say they are disciples. How do you know you're a disciple? Do you have the mark of a true disciple? Are you out there with a vision of what Jesus came here for? Are you out there living the life he wanted you to live, which made you to come? And you say you are a member of the church. You can be a member of the church and not a disciple. Today we see all these things. So God is doing this for our good. And the way God does this thing, what he does is he will do it by doing it by bringing love into the heart of the man. Because love is the foundation of it all. Love, what is God talking about? When he takes your heart, when he dissects your heart and finish with your heart, he will leave something that is called love. It's called agape love. He dropped that love into you. Oh, glory to God. Oh, glory to God. See, in John chapter 3, verse 16, the Bible says, For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. So to be a true disciple, you see, that aspect of love, God must drop into your heart called the agape love. That's the kind of love that the Bible says in Romans chapter 5, verse 5. That he has shared his love abroad in our hearts. That love he has shared abroad in our heart is what made you and me to do things for God without ulterior motives. Is that love that makes you to do actions or you do what you do without having ulterior motives? What are ulterior motives? Your motive is not because you want profit, you want gain, because you want people to see you. You see, there are things you do in secret. Only because only God is about him. It's not about being a man's pleaser. The Bible makes us understand when we read the other time. You see, love is what motivates a true child of God to obey the word of God. Because I love him, I will not sin against him. Love is what motivates that agape love for the Father motivates them to say, oh, because I will fear my God, or I fear God because I love him. I reference him because I love him. You see, I am honoring the word of God. I am taking it and to live by the word of God because I do what I love him. It's all about loving God. But you see, you and me, human beings, you cannot love God except God take hold of your heart. If you harden your heart and you refuse him to take your heart, there's no way you have the capability to really love God. Very, very important. Very, very important. Amen. Because let me say this again. If God does not take hold of the heart of a man or a woman and then do his surgery into that heart, and after he's done, release his love into the heart of that person, that man or woman will find it difficult to live for God and to give God glory and to serve God. It will be difficult for them. Because love is what motivates people to live holy. Love is what motivates people to go out and look for souls. And that love, I repeat, cannot come except God himself take hold of that heart. Work on it and release that agape love. Because everything was done out of love. For God so had what? Love. Then he did what? He gave. And the Bible makes us understand that in Romans 5:5, he has kept abroad in our heart that aspect of that love. To make us to live like him, to talk like him, to operate like him. Now, with this guy, with that level, guess what? That is the level whereby you can go into depth, into length, into height, into dimension, into great depthness with God, and you don't mind. You can go that thus far with God into dimensions and length and all that because. You now know that all that glitter is not gold. You now know that it is all about me going to heaven. And that case, you can forsake whatever that the Bible is letting you know that is not of God. Amen. So, listen to this. This is also very important. Another aspect about this today is for those who have mentors and they are learning under those people, and those people are supposed to make their what? Disciples. Man or brother or sister, be careful. Be careful who is discipling you. Be careful who you consider your mentor. It is very important. Because they can either mentor you to heaven or mentor you to hell. So please, we have a lot of young, aspiring young guys today. Young guys, young preachers. They want to be like Bishop this. They want to be like Apostle this. They are jumping and following after all these guys. And most of them who say they are learning from these people, some of them don't even understand what they are getting. They don't even understand. Why am I saying this? Because guess what? The Bible says there are many that say they are pastors and they are not. Be very careful. There are many that say they are apostles and they are not. There are many that say they are prophets and they are not. So don't just go after the buoyancy and all those things. No, no, no. Look at the lifestyle. Look at their fruits that they produce. The first thing before talking about their commission, before talking about the vision they have, look at their lifestyle. Do they live like Christ? Do they have those fruits like Christ? Can they be considered true mentors? Because if the man is not like Christ, why following the man? If the man is not living like Christ before you, why following the man? Because Jesus is telling you that a disciple can be like a master, and the man that you are following as a master, he cannot be like his own master. What is your problem? Your problem is because you want money? Your problem is because you want them to know you too, that you're part of him? You want also that you might grow like him? That he might transfer some wicked spirit upon you in the name of anointing, transfer? Young people, be careful. It is very that that is how it is so complicated today in our days. For the Bible says if they were of us, they would not have gone away. Many have gone away because they were not of us. Paul talked about false brethren. That one of the issues that he had in the church in his day. Paul talked about the theory of false brethren, false hold. There are people who are false brethren in the churches. They are not disciples. They say they are members. God will help us. You see, Jesus said about abiding in him in John chapter 8. Let's go to John chapter 8. In this aspect of disciple, let's look at John chapter 8. By the grace of God, and we shall be wrapping it up. Thank you, Lord Jesus. This is so serious. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Then said Jesus to those Jews which believe on him, if he continue in my word, then are he my disciples indeed. John 8:31. If he continues in my word, then you are my disciples indeed. So, you say you're a disciple of Christ. You go to church and the Bible is telling you and me that we should go and make disciples. Why make disciples? Because any man that is not a disciple, that you have not come to this point of a disciple. As a matter of fact, let me say this. Every child of God, any man that said they are born again, that you have come to Christ, God expects you to be a disciple. He expects you to be a disciple. He's not looking for you to be a member of a church. That's not what he's looking for. He came here to make men to be disciples. Disciples, people who observe all truths. I don't want to go through the message again. You got it. But the point I want to see is that, listen to this. He says, if you do not abide in my way, you are not my disciple. You say you are in church. Where is your Bible? How often do you spend with the scriptures? Or is it your phone that is your Bible? That you spend 8 hours on Facebook, YouTube, WhatsApp, watching from one YouTube program, going after one prophet, the other on YouTube, checking on all the garbage and junk they are doing out there in the name of prophecies. Are you saying you are a Christian? When you have left the matter of the day, abiding in the true word of God, and you have gone after people who are telling you stories, liars of course, telling you stories, I am talking out of experience because some of them have already said it, that they think they were saying they were lying, that they were deceiving so many souls, flashing what they don't have. How God is squeezing them now, some of them now, to come out and repent real good. So God cannot lie. God means God cannot. No, no. Prophet, they are not. Now, shake your life. Have you laid your hand on the plow and you are taking it away? And you are looked back? Then you are not yet saved. You are born again, you say you are born again, it's fake. After looking at this, does your life match up to who is the disciple? Or are you those people who are playing darkness, playing light, playing darkness, playing light? I don't care whether you are the bishop of your church. The truth is that you are not born again. You cannot serve God and serve mammon. And you say you are born again. When you have not abandoned this world and deny yourself, you cannot say you are born again. When you have not separated yourself to abide in the word of God and love the word of God with all your heart, your born again is questionable. So, dear brethren, this is one of the mystery of born again revealed, the aspect of being a disciple. So when somebody say, what do you mean by some people are not really born again? By their fruits you shall know them. What fruits? Their lifestyle fruits, their outward manifestation fruits. You see, that's why Bible says, judge yourself that you don't be judged. Judge yourself already. You know why? You say judge yourself. Because that means that you use the Bible. When you use the Bible, and the Bible look at you, you look at the Bible. The Bible is a mirror. It reads you, it reads you. The Bible, you read the Bible, it also reads you. What does the Bible tell you? Say, that one is not right. Remove it. That one is not right. Stop it.